Oh, yeah.
Okay, I'll talk about contextual and non-contextual experiments with perspectives to the way in which we can carry out related computation on distributed systems and clusters. So this problem recently achieved a lot of attention due to recent experimental capabilities of handling photons. We can now engineer states of photons, in particular quantum angular momentum, photon-photon angular momentum, so that single photons can support Hilbert spaces of dimensions that are higher than 100. So, for example, this recent experimental implementation of contextual sets, so-called Cohen-Specker sets in particular, shows how simple the implementation is now by means of exploitation of the angular momentum Hilbert space. That also provoked many theoretical researches and projects which can be traced in citation of the original Cohen-Specker theorem paper, which all of these works now cite. Contextuality versus non-contextuality is a pretty simple concept where we can actually understand this definition by referring to a device which has got filters for the same system repeatedly coming through it and coming out to different ports. For example, Stern-Gerlach device for spins 3/2, 4 ports, and that means 4-dimensional space, and that means that particles have to appear at one of the ports. And that means that classical systems do keep and remember their states through all repeated passings through the device, as opposed to quantum particles that have got different outputs with respect to the previous filters they went through. So the Cohen-Specker sets are notorious as the best simulators of such conditions, because classical systems cannot pass, as we'll see later on, particular set of ports, and that enables us to differentiate between quantum and classical systems, and that also makes a difference between possible quantum computers and classical computers eventually and in the end. With respect to this contextuality, non-contextuality, we have also got a simple definition of Cohen-Specker set. We ascribe 1 to a port through which a particle appeared and 0 to all the others through which a particle didn't go. That's the vector system of equations that are characteristic of orthogonality, and this is simply a problem which is unfeasible in a head-on approach. For example, for the simplest possible Cohen-Specker system, which is called Cohen-Specker set, we would need the age of the universe on all the computers on the Earth. So I succeeded in transferring this exponential complexity of the problem to polynomial complexity by correlating the nonlinear systems with the hypergraphs, and in that way I'm able to use a shortcut to find Cohen-Specker systems, although recently we faced similar problem as CERN, and we would really need quantum computers, because we'll see later we are generating a huge amount of data, and we have to elaborate this data and process them, and that is a very demanding task for the present clusters, as we'll see later on. In the meantime, I'll just explain what the MMP formalism is. We ascribe an ASCII character to each of the vertices, and we denote the orthogonality by means of connecting vertices within an edge. So the simplest possible hypergraph here explains what the meaning of the locality versus non-locality is. Each edge is a set of the output ports, so where a particle must appear, and we see that in such a configuration of repeated going through devices, we can ascribe at most 4 ones to particular vertices with that request that particle comes out through one of them. But for classical particle, we have always got 1 edge to which we cannot ascribe any ones of the outputs, and that would mean that no particle appears at all. So it's an impossible task for a classical particle. Only quantum particle will always appear with some probability. On an average, in many repeatings, they'll all have the probability of 25% of appearance. The complexity I mentioned before, you can see here, I haven't been able to generate
less than 61 edges per 60 vertices exhaustively,
because the data that correspond to that exceed many terabytes of storage space, and that's just a no-go approach. Therefore, I approach the problem in a way which actually generates the data randomly in many repeated attempts. And that means also that the sequential processing is preferred over parallel one, because unknown structure of the nodes sometimes require a magnitude of more time than the others, and it's simply unpredictable. So serial jobs give much better results and provide us with the data in a shorter time. And especially with respect to the fact that we have to gather the data that enable us to recognize a new kind of algorithm which would speed up the whole process, and for that we need all the subsets. And for example, in this case of 6075 class of problems, we obtained some of the subsets only after more than 1 billion of the KS sets generated. So, since this is important for the development of the future quantum computing algorithms and quantum cryptography, and since the Cohen-Sperker sets are actually equivalent to non-local sets, that can also serve us for formulating and selecting candidates for one-way computing. It's very important to generate all the sets and to store them somewhere. So that's another example from this class. So we face similar problem as with the nuclear waste. We have to keep it somewhere for the future usage. We have to keep the nuclear waste to save us for some time. And we should keep our contextual sets somewhere until the quantum computers are developed in order to be able to use them. On the other hand, we have got a possibility to develop better algorithms. One example, at the beginning I started to generate then known sets as a comparison, only three sets from that space were known and found by humans. And then I generated all the sets and recognized the algorithms which speed up the generation several orders of magnitude. So that's very important for that purpose. Now we are dealing with the 6075 and 6105 four-dimensional systems, and with 236, 1216 sets, which are huge in six dimensions. And we would need to find some new algorithms that would reduce that and speed up the generation of such sets. I have to find the place where I can store this data, and so far I wasn't successful, because people are just producing results and then discard data, and the data should be stored for the future usage, and that's the next problem. Also, the problem which we face here is the problem of how to use our computer system. And the main message from this application is that we should somehow divide the efforts of humans, so to say, with the efforts of analyzing data, because all the new classes were devised in such a way that the symmetry was recognized, the higher symmetry was recognized by humans, and then the problems was reduced by different algorithms to a huge amount of data that came out from such a high symmetry sets. So somehow the solutions should be divided, should not be too automatized. At the beginning I applied a completely automatized approach, which was then stacked very soon at the very low level. That was that.
Yeah, but storing this kind of data in classical digital form.
The problem is I need huge files to store somewhere because the hypergraphs are mixed up together, and to search through them, you have to have all available simultaneously. Yeah. That means.
Yeah, but what I was thinking, for example, let's take a normal analog carrier, whatever.
Yeah.
Where you can actually have a lot of different frequencies in the same moment.
Mm-hmm.
So you could actually store the data not bit by bit as we do it on a digital medium.
Yeah.
But the kind of frequency spectrum by frequency spectrum and collect them much more together.
Mm-hmm.
Several hundreds perhaps of levels. But then you have also, if it's a good algorithm, you can also read them out in a way.
Yeah, that would be possible.
Just as an idea of possible storage.
Yeah, in particular because the ASCII characters and hypergraphs do not require digital.
Actually analog devices which.
Translation.
Yeah. So perhaps this kind of fresh memory subsystem.
Yeah, the problem is I'm trying to put this terabyte of data somewhere for further usage. I mean, you see, that's a scale which is comparable to this one. I don't know how fast we are going to find quantum computers, but quantum computers require a new kind of algorithms and a new kind of architecture, and we do need them because this problem also reflects our shortage of resources in general. And all talks here are actually busy with this problem. We can parallelize, extend, and so on, but we are always limited by this exponential complexity, and in the end we are going to cover the whole Earth by processors, and we are not going to solve the problem. We cannot develop without...
We know that we search for the answer 42 anyway.
Yeah.
So why bother?
All right, well,
okay.
Thank you again.